Assalamu alaikum students. Today our topic of discussion is the placenta. Placenta is an organ characteristic of true mammals during pregnancy. It joins the mother and the offspring, allowing the selective exchange of soluble blood-borne substances by apposition of uterine and trophoblastic tissues. Literally, the placenta means the cake. The title is based on the flat, discoid appearance of the freshly delivered placenta. The human placenta belongs to the hemochorial type of placentas, in which the maternal blood comes in direct contact with the fetal chorionic layer. Now, developmentally, the placenta consists of two parts, the fetal part and the maternal part. The fetal part, it develops from the chorionic sac. It is known as chorionic frontosum. And maternal part is derived from the endometrium, that is the functional layer, which is known as decidua basalis. After delivery of the fetus, rapid reduction in the size of uterus leads to detachment of the placenta from the uterine wall. The uterus then undergoes a series of contractions due to which the placenta and its associated membranes, that is the fused amnion and the smooth chorion, are forced out of the uterus and passed to the exterior through the vagina. The freshly delivered placenta is a discoid organ measuring. So here you can see it is a discoid organ. It measures about 20 cm in diameter and 3 cm in thickness. It has two surfaces, a fetal surface and a maternal surface. The fetal surface is covered by amnion and hence appears smooth and shiny. So the fetal surface is covered with amnion. Hence it is smooth and shiny. The umbilical cord attached near the center of this surface. So this is the fetal surface. It is covered by the amnion, so it is smooth and shiny, and this is the umbilical cord which is attached at its center. Through the translucent amnion, the chorionic plate is visible and chorionic blood vessels are seen to be radiating away from the attachment of the umbilical cord. You can see the umbilical vessels, they are radiating away from the attachment of the. So on the fetal surface, the umbilical cord is visible and the amnion is visible and the blood vessels are visible underneath the amnion. These blood vessels are present in the chorionic plate. While the maternal surface of the placenta is dark red in color, it is covered by a thin shaggy layer of decidua basalis. So this is the thin layer of decidua basalis. Here it is removed, which appears reddish gray in color. In the maternal surface presents a number of convex, somewhat polygonal areas. You can see here polygonal or convex areas which are separated from each other by shallow grooves. These bulging areas are 15 to 30 in number and they represent the cotyledons of the placenta. The fetal part of the placenta is formed by the chorionic frontosum, as I have told you before, which consists of chorionic plate and chorionic villi. Now, this chorionic plate is composed of three layers. The extra embryonic mesoderm, which is shown here, extra embryonic mesoderm. This is the innermost layer, the cytotrophoblastic layer, shown in light green color, and this syncytiotrophoblastic layer, which is shown in the dark green color. This chorionic plate bears the chorionic villi. Now, these syncytiotrophoblasts, cytotrophoblasts, and somatic layer of extra embryonic mesoderm, these collectively are known as chorion. The chorion is formed during the second week of development and it constitutes a sac, which is known as chorionic sac. So, this is the chorionic sac, which forms the outermost wall of the conceptus. So this is the outermost wall of the conceptus. This is the conceptus and this is the outermost wall which is known as chorionic sac or chorion. Very soon, finger-like process called chorionic villi developed on it. The earliest chorionic villi they appear on the as the clumps of the cytotrophoblast having an outer layer of the outer covering of the syncytiotrophoblast, and they are known as primary chorionic villi. So these are the primary chorionic villi. You can see here this one, the outer covering of the syncytiotrophoblast and the finger-like projection of the cytotrophoblast, this one. So this is the primary villi. Now this primary villi will undergo a series of change in the second and third weeks, and then secondary and tertiary villi are formed. So here you can see the primary villus, it consists of outer layer of syncytiotrophoblast, while inner core is formed by the cytotrophoblast. Very soon, the extra embryonic mesoderm, it also invades this villi. And now, after invasion of the mesoderm, this is known as secondary villus. Here you can see the syncytiotrophoblast, the cytotrophoblast, and then the mesodermal core. This is the secondary villus. Now, by the end of third week, blood vessels they develop in the mesenchymal core of the villi, which are now known as the tertiary villi or the definitive villi. The capillaries of the tertiary chorionic villi quickly establish connection with the blood vessels, which develop in the extra embryonic mesoderm of the chorion and the connecting stalk. So you can see here, so these are the blood vessels which are developing in the this tertiary villus, and they establish contact with the blood vessels in the extra embryonic mesoderm of the chorion and connecting stalk. Here these blood vessels are developing. As the tertiary chorionic villi develop, the cytotrophoblastic cells in some of these villi penetrate through the overlying syncytiotrophoblast and they reach the decidua. So these cells start penetrating, and they ultimately the cytotrophoblastic cells are reaching towards the decidua. Now here you can see the cells of cytotrophoblast have migrated and they have reached the endometrium or the decidua of the maternal uterus. Neighboring outgrowths of the cytotrophoblastic cells meet to form the spherical cytotrophoblastic shell around the conceptus. So this shell is formed by the cytotrophoblastic layer. This shell attaches the chorionic sac firmly to the decidual stroma, and gradually the syncytial cells also spread over the cytotrophoblastic shell, and thus whole of the intervillous space it becomes completely lined with the syncytiotrophoblast. Here you can see the whole of the intervillous space is completely lined by the syncytiotrophoblast. The trophoblastic shell is interrupted only by the maternal blood vessels. So these are the maternal blood vessels which are interrupting the trophoblastic shell. Most of the early tertiary chorionic villi, they do not show side branching and extend all the way from the chorionic plate to the decidua bacillus. These are known as stem villi or anchoring villi because their tips are firmly attached to the maternal tissue. Now during the second month, the stem villi develop many side branching, which results in formation of large number of free villi which project in all directions into the intervillous space. So you can see here these are the villi which are developing in the second month, and these villi, also called terminal villi, present a very large surface area. It is almost 11 square meters for the exchange of material between the maternal and fetal blood.
Now this is the chorionic sac showing the villi, and you can see here that they are well developed at the embryonic pole. Then the embryonic at the embryonic pole, rather at the embryonic pole. So these tertiary villi, this chorionic frondosum structure is more developed at the embryonic pole. So this is chorionic frondosum. This is the original picture, developing embryo, chorionic frondosum, bushy or bushy chorion formed by the chorionic villi. And you can see here that it is not well developed at the embryonic pole. Again, chorionic villi, chorionic frondosum, and this is smooth chorion. So decidua is the term used for uterine lining, that is the endometrium, during the pregnancy. It has got three layers: decidua basalis, where the implantation takes place and the basal plate is formed. So this is the decidua basalis part. This is the uterine endometrium of the mother, and this is decidua basalis is the part where the implantation occurs. So this is the decidua basalis, while decidua capsularis is like a capsule and it is around the embryonic pole, around the chorion. This is the part of the endometrium which surrounds the embryonic pole. Decidua parietalis, this is on the opposite uterus wall. Here you can see the rest of the uterine endometrium is the decidua parietalis.
In the early weeks of gestation, the chorionic villi cover the entire outer surface of the chorion. So this is the entire outer surface of the chorion, and they cover the entire, but although they are less developed in on that part of chorionic sac which lies under the decidua capsularis. So this is the decidua capsularis, and you can see here that less number of the villi are not developed here. As the chorionic sac grows and expands in size, the decidua capsularis is gradually stretched. Consequently, the villi lying under the decidua capsularis becomes compressed, their blood supply is reduced, and finally they degenerate and disappear. By the fourth month, most of the chorion under decidua capsularis become devoid of villi. This area is known as chorionic leaf. So this is the area which is known as chorionic leaf, where under pressure the chorionic villi have disappeared. While the chorionic villi under the decidua capsularis are degenerating, the villi related to the decidua basalis increases in number and enlarge and branch profusely. Here you can see this part of chorion gives a bushy appearance in sections and is known as chorionic frondosum. So this part is known as chorionic frondosum. Here the chorionic leaf has joined the decidua capsularis, decidua parietalis.
Maternal part of placenta is derived from decidua basalis. The deep part of the decidua basalis, which lies against the chorionic frondosum, becomes incorporated into the placenta as the decidual plate. So this is the decidual plate. This become incorporated. This part of the decidua basalis becomes incorporated into the placenta. The basal plate is composed of mixture of decidual and trophoblastic tissues. In addition, deposits of an amorphous material called fibrinoid are also present in the basal plate, especially at its junction with the rest of the decidua basalis. The spiral uterine arteries run obliquely through the basal plate to open into the intervillous space through the holes and gaps present in the cytotrophoblastic shell. So these are the spiral arteries which are going inside the intervillous space. During the fourth and fifth months of development, the intervillous space becomes divided into 15 to 30 compartments by partitions which are known as placental septa or decidual septa. These septas are wedge-like projections of the decidual plate covered by trophoblast that extend from the basal plate partway towards the chorionic plate. The compartments formed by the placental septa, they are known as cotyledons. The maternal surface of the placenta, it consists of, as I have told you, cotyledons, about 15 to 30 slightly bulging villous areas, and their surface are covered by shreds of decidua basalis. So cotyledons are covered by decidua basalis from the uterine wall. After birth, the placenta is always carefully inspected for missing cotyledons. Cotyledons remaining attached to the uterine wall after birth may cause severe bleeding. Fetal side is smooth and shiny. You can see here it is smooth and shiny. It is covered by amnion. The umbilical cord is attached close to the center of the placenta. This is the umbilical cord. The umbilical vesicles radiate from the umbilical cord and they branch on the fetal surface to form the chorionic vessels. They enter the chorionic villi to form the arteriocapillary venous system. Now, how the placenta grows? About fourth month of pregnancy, the placenta is well-developed structure. As pregnancy advances, it occupies about 30% of the internal uterine surface till the birth of the baby. Thickness of placenta, it also increases during this period. During 4 to 5 months of the development, the intervillous spaces are divided into compartments by partitions called the placental septa, which are produced by the decidual tissues, as I have told you before. And these compartments are known as cotyledons. And I have told you about the importance of these cotyledons. So these are the cotyledons compartments produced by the placental septa. So the placental barrier, initially it is formed by the cells of the syncytio trophoblast. Cells, the cytotrophoblast. Mesoderm, and then endothelium. Later on in the later part of the pregnancy, the placenta barrier is formed only by the syncytio trophoblast and the endothelium of the fetal capillaries. So these two layers form the placental barrier or the placental membrane, through which the exchange of material occurs. So the functions of the placenta, three main functions are there. Number one is metabolism. Number two is transport of gases and nutrients. And number three is endocrine secretion. Now the metabolic function of the placenta particularly in early pregnancy synthesizes glycogen, cholesterol and fatty acids, which serve as a source of nutrients and energy for the embryo or the fetus. Many of its metabolic activities are undoubtedly critical for its other two major placental activities. Placental transfer. The transport of substances in both directions between the fetal and maternal blood is facilitated by the great surface area of the placental membrane. Almost all materials are transported across the placental membrane by one of the following four main transport mechanisms. That is, one is the simple diffusion, second is the facilitated diffusion, third is the active transport, and then the pinocytosis. The substances which cross the placental barrier are the gases. Oxygen passes from the maternal blood to the fetal blood, whereas carbon dioxide passes from the fetal to maternal blood. Nutrients. Nutrients are transferred from the maternal to fetal blood by simple diffusion, facilitated diffusion, or active transport. Water, glucose, amino acids, vitamins, and minerals cross the placental membrane easily. Generally, lipids do not cross the placental barrier, but the free fatty acids can pass from the maternal into fetal blood. Now, waste products like urea and uric acid pass from the fetal into maternal blood by simple diffusion. Most of the drugs consumed by the mother can cross the placental membrane by simple diffusion because many drugs have teratogenic properties and they can cause developmental anomalies. Extreme caution should be exercised while prescribing a drug to the pregnant woman. Antibodies belonging to the IgG class are transferred from the maternal to fetal blood across the placental membrane by pinocytosis. Maternal antibodies provide immunity to the fetus against some infections like infectious diseases like diphtheria, measles, and smallpox. This passive immunity is very important because the newborn does not have the capability to produce its own antibodies for some period after birth. So, placental endocrine synthesis and secretion. Using precursors derived from the fetus or the mother, this in situ trophoblast of the placenta synthesizes protein and steroid hormones. The protein hormones synthesized by the placenta are human chorionic somatotropin or human placental lactogen, human chorionic thyrotropin, human chorionic corticotropin. So, abnormalities of placenta. First of all, the abnormalities of placenta, that is its abnormal position. Abnormal implantation of the conceptus in the lower part of the body of uterus results in formation of placenta previa. So, this is the placenta. These are the various types of placenta previa, which partially or completely covers the internal os of the uterus. Placenta previa is of great clinical importance because it usually leads to vaginal bleeding during third trimester of the pregnancy. The bleeding called antepartum hemorrhage, it is caused by expansion and stretching of the lower half of the uterus, which leads to tearing of the placenta away from the uterine wall. Sometimes the placenta previa completely obstructs the internal os of the uterus, as in this case. In such cases, birth of the fetus through the vagina is not possible and it has to be delivered by cesarean section. Normally, the placental attachment is easily detached from the uterine wall during the third stage of the labor. But sometimes the chorionic villi invade the full thickness of the endometrium and becomes adherent to the myometrium. So, such placenta is called placenta accreta, which invade the full thickness of the endometrium and becomes adherent to the myometrium. So, this is placenta accreta. Very rarely, the chorionic villi penetrate the full thickness of the myometrium and reach the perimetrium. And in such cases, the abnormality is called the placenta purkreta. So this is the placenta percreta. The placenta accreta as well as percreta are excessively adherent to the uterine wall and lead to clinical condition of retained placenta. So abnormalities of shape of placenta. Normally the placenta has a circular shape, but occasionally it may have oval or fusiform, concentric or other shapes. The placenta may be notched or lobed. All these variations in shape are clinically unimportant because they do not cause any problem. Now accessory placentas. Occasionally there are one or more accessory placenta which are of smaller size than the main placenta. Here you can see the accessory placenta or sanctuate lobe. An accessory placenta is also known as placenta sanctuata. The accessory placenta is connected to the main placenta only by membranes and blood vessels. You can see here membranes and blood vessels. Placenta sanctuata, it constitutes clinically significant placental abnormality because the accessory placenta may be retained while the main placenta is delivered during the third stage of the labor. The retained pieces of placental tissue prevents complete contraction of the uterus and may lead to excessive bleeding from the vagina after the childbirth. Such a bleeding is known as postpartum hemorrhage. Now, normally the placental cord is attached near the center of the placenta. The umbilical cord is attached near the center of the placenta. Sometimes the cord is attached to the edge of the placenta, and such a placenta is called battledore placenta. Rarely the umbilical cord is attached to the membranes at some distance from the margin of the placenta, and the umbilical vessels run on the membrane for some distance before reaching the placenta. This condition is called velamentous insertion of the umbilical cord, and in such cases the placenta is called the placenta velamentosa. So here you can see velamentous placenta, and this is the battledore or the marginal insertion of the umbilical cord. You can see here. I hope now you have understood the structure of the placenta, the placental barrier, the material crossing the placental barrier, this placental barrier, and various anomalies which are associated with the formation of placenta. Thank you so much.